branches out into like a thousand categories. Are you indirect about your freedom, or do you have to like seek a sequence? Are you directly responsible? What makes you accountable? And you bring like this very big pool of what it means basically to act as a human being, and that is tied to how you actually make decisions. Of course, you have the decision making presented by the rational choice theory, and then you got the behavioral, which brings in a bit of an irrational and spontaneous way of how people make decisions. But what came to mind when I was thinking about the context of design, and based on what we discussed last time with Mark, actually designers, when it comes to the philosophy of decision making, they are very specific. As you know, designers are very specific philosophers when it comes to decision making, because of the principles that you kind of have to implement as a designer to constrain the number of choices someone has to have in order to interact optimally with what you create, with what you give. So we don't actually give people freedom. We don't empower them with a direct freedom in relationship to the object that we give, but we may be empowered to them beyond that, if that's the intention, you know, the intention beyond the interaction with the object, that is the fulfilling experience, which is a sense of liberation, if I may say. I don't know. But yeah, just that's what came on top of my mind. I've always tried to think about the tools I create and how I'm trying so hard to constrain, just to give people clarity to understand what's going on, but then the processes that are involved and the kind of creativity that surfaces needs to be as open and as tailored to the person. They have to make their own choices in there, and I think that's why sometimes it's really difficult to navigate certain complex challenges with these tools. So yeah, I don't know what's actually freedom, first of all, in decision making. Because, you know, there's the paradox of choice, having too many choices, but also not having at all, not having the right ones. What does it actually mean for a designer to enable or constrain choice? And the kind of pressure that it comes to the designer to make decisions themselves. It's a lot of decisions for everyone and in very different ways. Yeah. Begin discussion.
Before we go, sorry, I just want to say that don't be afraid to discuss. We are not philosophers here. Well, except maybe some of us that have like a degree or something like that in the topic. we are not philosophers, so we are all at the same level. I mean, at least as understanding goes. And if you want, maybe for those who of you that we don't know you, I don't know you, at least like Dami and Aura, like you are joining the conversation, don't hesitate to introduce you yourself before we start. We can do the same so everyone knows each other. I think it will ease the conversation. So yeah, go ahead, whoever wants to talk.
I can do it. So my name is Aurora. I've done art direction studies that I finished years ago. And next year I'm going to do a postgraduate in UK. So I'm a bit like in between studies and trying to get new knowledge to find something after my postgraduate degree of next year. So yeah.
Thank you.
That's all.
I don't know who wants to go next, who has anything to say.
Are we doing intros then?
Or, yeah, you can do like a brief intro maybe and go if you have something in mind. Sure. About the topic. You can go ahead.
Sure, yeah. So my name's Matt. I came from a renewable energy background and petroleum engineering, so from an energy background. The previous discussion kind of inspired me to launch an app about decision making to help, I guess, like a layperson be able to have an introductory ability to make decisions based upon maximizing entropy. And so not just like energy entropy, but like information entropy. And so I just took those probabilities, plugged it into those two equations with Kelly Criterion and Shannon Hartley. And I just called it Alien Logic App because the buzzword is about AI. But I think one of the issues about AI is that humans and machines do not interact very well with one another. There's both good and bad, right? Like with humans, we have, you know, brilliant intuitions. We have culture as a background for garnering insights that can be somewhat hyper efficient in some cases. But in other cases, we have a lot of things that reduce our ability to be rational. So in terms of like rational choice theory, we're not really rational agents. Rational agency is more of a proxy and a way to like, you know, kind of affirm, you know, liberalism as a philosophy. But we kind of need that in order to build society and have that kind of framework. One thing that Diana kind of mentioned was, you know, trying to just go against the grain to minimize an influence sometimes has quite the opposite effect. You know, if you, and this kind of reminds me of this Girardian view, which is that if you want to be super authentic and you look at those around you who are not authentic and you decide to do the opposite, then all you get is just a negative Girardian perspective, and you're not really liberated. You're just trapped in a different frame by just trying to copy the ideal of the opposite. And I feel like to be liberated is extremely difficult. Getting a, you know, a completely new perspective and getting out of this kind of Girardian trap, you have to, you know, come up with you know, a lot of new key insights that are just not usually out there. And so I think philosophy doesn't necessarily give you the answers, but it helps you think through these things a little bit better.
Who's next? You don't have necessary to reply to Matt or to any point that is already made. Like if you want to discuss, like speak about what it means for you, decision making, and how does that relate for you as to design or philosophy in any way, just don't hesitate. Hey. I don't know. No, I will try to go as well with some ideas. So I'm a senior designer. Many people would categorize me in the realm of UX design or service design, depends. I'm basically interested in many things, and philosophy is part of it. But I'm not close to have like a full understanding of all the concepts related to decision making and frameworks in philosophy, at least. But there's something that I find interesting in bringing some recent ideas about how we act or enact the world as a relationship between what we see as possible within a given context and what we perceive as what we can do with what is possible in that context, right? So there's some kind of relationship between what is available to us and what kind of capabilities we feel we have in order to take one of these options to act upon them. So to me, it's like we can put aside the paradox thing from an observational standpoint, where it's not really a paradox because we only play with what is actually accessible to us, either in terms of the environment that opens up those kind of options and what we are capable of doing as a human being with the skills we have and the type of prior knowledge we have. So I would say something that is specific to design is that we try in some way or shape to either increase or decrease certain options, right? Or certain type of options. So in certain situations, we see that we have certain options available that doesn't satisfy the kind of outcomes we want to create. So we do whatever process or exercise or method that helps us to either, like in this case, we are stuck in a place where the option available are not satisfiable. So basically, we want to increase the option available. So we create some kind of process or method that allows us to generate more options, like to go sideways, to escape the situation we are in, bringing the diversity that was not here before, and then be able to perceive other options and use that kind of sidestep or either going in the opposite direction that what was expected as a creative way to escape the situation, right? And find new options that were not available prior to whatever we started to do. And this is in some way what design processes are about. Either they provide this kind of creation of option, or they provide a reduction of option by allowing us to define criteria of selection and reduction that satisfies whatever outcomes we want to bring. So in this idea that the medium we try to create, the objects that we try to create, are not the ends of whatever design we are trying to do, but they are the medium through which we want the change to happen. Like say, we are in a situation where we want people to, like, I don't know, like to change the way they do a certain thing. We will create maybe an object it's an app, a website, a physical object, or a process that changed that situation. The whatever process we were engaged in is the creation of this medium that allows this kind of change. But in that sense, it's probabilistic because we are not sure it will bring exactly a specific change. It will bring a certain type of change we want to see. So there's some kind of uncertainty here that I find interesting and that we have to deal with that I don't necessarily see in at least in the type of frameworks that I know of in philosophy, where things are rather explicit in the type of either in the type of action or options that we tend to take. So that's my thoughts. I don't know who wants to build on that or bring other thoughts. I don't know. Do you see like it as a relevant description of what design is about, you know, decisions and action, and whether it's something that you feel is probably different from your point of view?
I mean, I totally agree with what you're saying, and I think, you know, there are then nuances. I think overall you have these two categories, like you're saying, you know, the creation of options and then the reduction of options, kind of what happens in practice. And then, you know, it boils down to the kind of decisions that you have to make, whether they are ethical decisions, whether they are like efficiency driver decisions, or finding these different dimensions to the, basically finding the purpose of each decision, which is not just to create options, but what are the kind of options that are created and the implications that follow. So I guess you, in a sense, there, even in inaction, there's a decision. A designer can make a negative decision, for example, not to act at all.
Yes.
Or, through that decision to, let's say, enforce a certain behavior, or even mutual decisions that may or not be relevant to the user itself, himself, but still have that, you know, you'd still have that option. Not every design is perfect and designed to fit as the designer nudges you to do. You can find your way around the tool, for example, and not feel bound to the constraints. It's not like he's pointing a gun at you and you have to respect it. You're not necessarily constrained to the point that your freedom is deprived. If you have the creativity and the need to outbreak, then you can still overrule it. And I think that's the power of decision making. It's by making a decision, you're not taking that person's right to make a decision further. You can condition it, or you can, you know, overrule it for a while, but this is not set in stone. This is not a immovable statement that, or an immovable power that you have over someone else, I think. Well, it depends, you know, if you design a prison, then things might be different, but I think products like apps and more virtual blueprints, I think that's fine. But I don't know, I leave it open. I don't know what to make of decision making, because I think this is my weakest suit that I have. So what is the challenge? You know, why is it hard to make decisions actually?
So yeah. I could try to approach it from either a quantitative perspective or broaden it out a little bit in a more philosophical way. But I kind of want to start with a quote that might bring in a little bit of insight about decision making. It's basically that, an experienced pilot, a well-skilled, experienced, superior pilot, doesn't get himself or herself into a situation where they have to display their superior fighting skills, right? And I think that has something to do with decision-making from Kevin's perspective, is that once you are in the method of exploring decision expansion, basically like increasing entropy, you discover and learn. And then when you discover and learn, you're on a different curve, because you failed. You failed multiple times, and that experience taught you how to avoid situations where you have to display a superior skill to get yourself out of a bad situation, right? So really the maximization isn't so much the ease, the maximization of experience, and I guess of the type of human intuitive goal seeking, is that in future iterations of games, like you take Go, for instance, right? You play in a way where it does not allow you to make the silly mistakes that got you to lose, right? And so this is where there is this type of efficiency, which is that you want to reduce choices because you want to reduce it down to the right ones. But you also want to expand your choices to make sure that you didn't, that your field, your search field is conclusive enough. So, you know, you're talking about like binary decision trees, but what happens, you know, if you're not a digital computer, right? You can't do binary search. You have some branches where there's like three or four other branches that are like or six. Do you always pick branches that give you more options? Well, maybe if you just if you're in the exploration mode. But if you're in the decision-making mode, where you actually have to pick branches based upon this, I don't know, this particular type of fractal number of branch, or, you know, every fork in these branches, then it becomes, you know, a different type of optimization thing that can get very complex, right? But one thing that I find in the real world, just to bring in a little bit of experience, is that your managers, or sometimes, you know, you, when you become a manager, right, you're kind of asked to become a philosopher, but like a bad one, like a poorly missed, basically, where you're given a limited budget, and you're asked to like produce you have to find a vendor that produces a certain outcome, right? And so then you go shop around through several, you know, SaaS companies, and then they all offer you everything, and they promise you everything, but then having to deal with it and building the product up, you know, it becomes laborsome, right? And while you're dealing with the sales process, you yourself go through this type of iteration process where you pretend that you're precise, that you fool yourself into thinking that you can get all of that and meet your budget. But you know, as you move forward, you know, and make those decisions, you realize that you were not precise enough and not realistic enough, and you trap yourself. Once you're three or four decisions in, and you can't, you know, reverse time and go back out. So,
So I think that the two really interesting things here about, you know, making decisions and then being able to live with the decision. And I think this distinction, it's sometimes missed when we make decisions like, oh, this is the best decision, but then you have to live with it. And what actually happens to you in that zone as you realize maybe it was a good decision for a thing, but then, you know, it brought different consequences to the table, or it just didn't feel right in terms of, we downplay our attitudes, the attitude we have to a certain decision, even though, you know, it sounds rational, it does make sense, we see all the benefits, then, you know, there still might be some misalignment to how we feel about it. And that has a real effect on the outcome, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, there's something interesting here that's, I would say, I'm living with decisions. That at some point we have to accept what is exactly our area of control, what we have control, actually true control of, and what we have not control of, right? What is this? It's not necessarily a clear boundary. It's more like something more porous, right? But there's a space where we can control certain things, and there's a lot of space where we don't control anything, right? And we are totally dependent and dependent on others, or situations, circumstances, and stuff like that. So, being aware and playing with this idea of having an area of control and a lot of space where we don't control anything is make things more acceptable when we don't achieve the kind of thing we wanted to achieve, or when we realized after the fact that the decision we made was just a bad decision, right? Because we can know what we could control of at the time we had control of the thing that we decided to act upon, right? So I think it's as a self individual philosophy, at least, is something that is, I find, powerful, at least for I mean, in the sense of you know, I mean, especially for designers, because I tend to see like some kind of common pattern within designers, which is that we all are a bit idealist, and you know, at the core, that we have some expectations on how the world should be and how the world should change, right? Although all of us don't agree necessarily on what are the type of changes and stuff like that, but we all have this some kind of idea of what change should be done and how we should do it. And because there's a misalignment between what we see as opportunities of change and what the others see as opportunity of change, right? There's this discrepancy is necessarily hard to handle, especially if we have like strong belief or strong ideas about this, you know, this ideal state of the world we should see. And what I mean by the world, I don't mean like the entire planet and everyone on it, right? It's what we see of right now that affects us or affects the people we work with, that we see as a necessary change for a better state, right? Which is a more contextual world than the entire planet. And something that was discussed before, like, made me think of the, you know, this path dependency theory, where basically the idea is that as more you take decision and time, you reduce the available, the options available to you, because you make critical judgments that narrows, they create a path that's at some point becomes clear and you cannot escape anymore, right? So decision that you make over time becomes like you had to make some decision, although you disagree with or you realize that they are ethically wrong or whatever, you feel like you are stuck and it had to, you know, you, if it were not you, others would have taken the same decision because you know, circumstances, right? So in this idea, there's some kind of situation where you can create to escape that fact that you are stuck in the kind of options you have access to. And it's again bringing diversity, like it's come from evolutionary algorithm, where basically when you are stuck in a local minima or local maxima, the only way to escape it is to bring diversity in the population. So it increases again the pool of option, and then you can create back this diversity of option and you can escape the situation, right? But if we left aside the algorithmic world and what they mean by that, which is about, you know, simulating population and most of the time the genes in population, you see it as ideas. Like if you imagine ideas as in evolutionary term, that they transmit, that they try to evolve to be more sticky, to stick to minds, and you know, stay alive, basically. And they mutate to in that idea. That if you are stuck in a place where you are only left with one idea, one type of idea, which has no, you know, no way to provide more options, that you need to introduce new ideas, new things that would bring new opportunities, and then you escape the situation. So yeah, two points on what has been said.
See, that's kind of what I mean by where when you look at some competitive games, you can see this analogy play out quite well. It's kind of like the game of chess. Once you become rather experienced enough and understand opening theory, the moves kind of become automatic. And it's almost as if your experience and learning and optimization has taken away your free will. It's not true. You still have free will, but the problem is that you've subscribed to a particular type of philosophy, which is efficiency and optimization. And as soon as you do that, it becomes automatic as a process of getting better. The problem is you become as good as the book that you're reading on chess theory. and not any much better, right? And so then the problem then becomes, well, at the very, very highest mark of, you know, a chess grandmaster, he or she must have experienced enough games and read enough chess theory books to be able to explore and understand even the most spontaneous types of exploration of the search trees. And, you know, this is one of the things that Magnus Carlsen does in a YouTube video of watching him just sacrificing his queen very early on just to get a positional and material evenness. And later on, he was able to win handily, right? Mm-hmm. Being able to be very daring at playing at a very high level does mean mastery in a sense, right? And so the question is, you know, sometimes when you're in a profession, you're not aiming to master. You're really just optimizing for your retirement, right? You're just trying to earn enough money, build enough skills, earn enough money through that profession, and then not really reach the pinnacle. Other professionals want to reach the pinnacle of the skill and knowledge of mastery, right? And so, you know, alignment is an issue with the people that you work with. Be able to motivate people, you know, having leverage, not just having control over your own free will, but being able to muster the ability to use others as leverage. And then that becomes an ethical issue, which is that how do you manipulate others, but also be ethical at the same time, right? And then it becomes a question of persuasion and alignment and so on and so forth. And there's also an introspection of how much are you being manipulated to pursue, you know, the ends of, you know, penultimate skill learning or knowledge driving or career pursuing, you know, goals.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I'll leave it off there for anyone else besides us three.
Anyone wants to go with something, anything, don't be afraid.
Oh, I'm not afraid. So one of the things that I think here, so we can split what Kevin was saying into two things. One is the conception of that more ideal state, even if it's local, right, of the thing that we want to achieve, mm-hmm. right? And then there's the, I don't know if tactical is the right word, but kind of is the manner in which we get there. And there can be disagreements at both those different levels. We can disagree on what that ideal outcome is, and then we can agree or disagree on the best path to get, right? And I think
yes.
Because I know, especially in design world, there are a ton of arguments over process.
Yes.
Right? You subscribe to one process or another, you believe in one method, whether it's like agile or lean or, you know, all the, and you mentioned it when you wrote earlier today about this idea of the language and the kind of theories of business versus philosophy that enter into the decision-making process. And I think they enter into those two things differently. I think in terms of conceiving of the world that we want, there is one type of input, which is, you know, a tug of war between a philosophical, you know, kind of conception of what that is, right? Mm-hmm. What is the perfect city? What is the perfect way to distribute X or Y or access this or that or to live or whatever? And then what is the best and most equitable or efficient way of getting there? And I think that modes of thinking are different in those two circumstances, right? There's one mode of thinking about the world that we want, right? Which is a more transparently philosophical discussion, right? The discussion which versus the more kind of the, what's the most efficient way to get there discussion, which is a more tactical discussion that is a little bit different and does lead itself to things like local maxima based on the book that you read, whether that book is chess theory or whether it's, you know, Girard's mimetic theory and that's the only thing that happens in Silicon Valley, or, you know what I mean? Like there's a lot of other books out there, and there are a lot of people that read one thing and then become like quite literally like indoctrinated, right? Like, or, you know, or this can go back to the like late 80s, early 90s, or early 80s, where like you can't read a text without holding it up against another text and discovering that it means nothing. Right. So every period kind of has its like has its blind spots. But I'm interested in both of those things as different discussions, I think.
Yeah.
Productively is probably what I'm getting at. And so and there's a professor at the University of Toronto who writes really interesting stuff. His name Mark Kingwell. And he wrote an actual book called The World We Want, which is an exploration into that kind of that idea of what are the founding ideas by which we are determining what the ideal outcome is in terms of a thrust, in terms of like a, you know, a societal thrust. What do we want? And I think that's an interesting place where philosophy and design. Sorry, I heard something.
Yeah, I heard something too. I wanted to just to say something on what you just mentioned, that these two, I don't know if we want to go in that direction today. I mean, it's a big topic, but there's one thing about language and the fact that today
design.
Oh, do you hear me now?
I do there, yeah, but didn't for a second. Was it just me, or is it?
Okay. No, if it's fine, yeah, okay. There's this notion of language and the fact that now design tends to relate more to, at least in the kind of ideas and the way we want to approach the thing we do, leans more towards business and engineering and tech. Whereas before it would have been most probably because there's some kind of idealization of what was design in the past and, you know, what was certain fields in the past, but more to arts and philosophy in that sense, that they have in nature and how they speak a big difference, that business and tech tends to be descriptive and explicit in the type of language they use, whereas arts and philosophy is not exactly like that, right? It tends to be more metaphorical and chooses ways to interconnect ideas and give, like, not necessarily bridges, but porous way to navigate ideas, which is not the case within the business world and engineering, which tends to be like what it is, like, you know, like a practice of technology, which are really, really explicit things, or business, which tend to describe how things happen. So I think there's a difference here that is noticeable in the sense that many commentators, like through the years, pretty much recently, tend to say that we don't have like any more this some kind of common shared idea about what the future is. And a good future, right? What is a good future? And as a shared understanding, I know that all of that is also pretty much idealized, that in the past we had this grand idea about the future and some of the common thread of futurism that was like an underlying concepts that were in people's minds, which tend to be now seen as like people that still adhere to this kind of ideas sounds like they are, you know, people that never really grown up, right? They like we can speak about Elon Musk for example, which the idea of flying cars and stuff like that, or tunnels with stuff like that. Like, you know, those are really old ideas in fact. So that we lack, we have lost some kind of imagination in society. Like, this is the common idea, that today we lack imagination. And if we turn to designers or design to ask for that, what we do with that, I don't feel like we have necessarily the good answers, because now we really lean towards technology and business, and we have the same answers. Maybe it's a broken analysis or understanding of mine. I don't say it is like that, but it's and it's not even necessarily entirely my perception, but it's something that we can read underneath certain commentary, right? I don't know if it's totally relevant to the discussion today, but yeah, this is what what you said, Mark, and it sits in my mind.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's a bit of well, I'll say it's a myth that previously there was a less fractured idea of some kind of common outcome, right? I think we are for narratives now, because the world is smaller than it used to be. But what we see as the previous striving for some kind of technological future really comes from a white Western European North American kind of concept of that future, right? That's not that it's not necessarily as popular a common understanding of what the future would be as it is in fact, right? I think that's one thing that we've come into contact with, and therefore the idea that there are fractured views of what the future is, I think, is natural, quote unquote, in a way, right? But what you said earlier about the idea of ideas, you know, having this kind of almost like a desire to remain, and now we have the pathways that these things can propagate more quickly.
Yes.
If less deeply, at least in a superficial way, mm-hmm. more quickly, there is a speed of the development of ideas, which I think that we're at a hinge right now when it comes to those ideas and this notion of kind of this post-truth world, which is really kind of equally a post-trust world, in the institutions mm-hmm. that anchor down some sets of thinking so that some ideas, whether they were democratically achieved or not, at least remained firmer for longer and therefore allowed more momentum around them, essentially, and that firmness is missing. So I think that's a really interesting, so how do you navigate that? How do you deal with philosophy, which is essentially trades in ideas in an environment where the half-life of ideas is shorter, potentially, right? So where does that put us?
I think, you know, as you're kind of talking about this great technological past that we've had, it kind of reminds me of that generation where they were able to accomplish the achieve so many, that aspirational movement, right, created not only, you know, this amazing accomplishment, which was the moon landing, but kind of invigorated an entire generation of engineers to come up with a lot of other things besides just that. And I think that obviously they've explored some of the edges and the boundaries of what are, you know, kind of considered our material limits, right? Material efficiency limits. Like, sure, we could build flying cars, but they would never be commercialized. So then once we I guess, you know, when I say that, right, I don't really actually mean it. What I mean, that type of cynicism only is actualized because once you actually do the work and do the Excel table and list down all the materials, you do realize that it's not, you know, commercially viable unless you reach a certain, you know, production number, right? And the demand isn't there unless you can create demand. And then it becomes somewhat of an abstract concept of how much are you willing to, you know, market or influence or do all of these manipulative tasks in order to create that market to achieve this type of technological end. I guess there's all these vision. Well, there, that's even more controversial, so it's not necessarily even easy, right? And then I think the last note, I think the more important notion that I came away with listening to you, Mark, was maybe this idea of this linear future. You know, again, the stock exchange or, you know, all of these types of leverage financing, right, is all built based upon this type of ingrained ethics, which is that there is a particular type of linearity, if not linearity, at least like predictability into the future. And so then really the rational decision is, you know, for all your savings, just go all in on investing into the future, right? So long as you're investing in something that's ethical, that's right, that has that kind of linear futuristic, you know, means, right? That's the worldview. That's the collective worldview of the West. And so then that is how resources should be allocated is in the future. But then it becomes kind of a little bit over-levered, and that becomes a problem. Whereas if you look at some of, you know, non-Western thinking, they have, there's a little bit of cyclicality, right? There isn't, you know, there is this one life and then there's that afterlife and it's based upon what you do here in this life, right? There's this type of reincarnation type of narrative, and that kind of makes it so that if you live your life in a type of cyclical, you know, metaphysical ethics worldview, then you're not going to put all your chips on the table in terms of investing into the future, but you want to save some things in the bank account. You want to be conservative, right? You want to like be able to make more on downtime, right? And so these things enter in, and I think that there is a radical destruction of the notion of linearity in recent years because of how much we know. You know, it's actually quite paradoxical, which is that the more you know, the more you know about your limits, right? And then the limits create those doubts, and the doubts create, you know, the action, which creates the inaction because of.
Yeah. I mean, I think there are also, like, you don't have to go far looking in front of your own nose to see the limits of our ability to deal with technology. Like, I mean, on a lighter note, I look around at people on bike paths with like rented scooters, like electric scooters, like wrapping themselves around tall telephone poles. And I'm thinking, it's a good thing we don't have jetpacks, right? Like, even just looking around, you know, there are examples of limits that we should be adhering to. And that's a lighthearted example, but I think there's other kind of evidence that has change that narrative, right? But yeah, I have seen that. That's what I thought when I saw my first scooter accident. It would have been just total carnage if it was two jetpacks.
Now I have in mind this flying, you know, bombs, basically.
It also makes me think about the, I don't know if you guys are watching that TV series called The Boys. You know, with superpowers, and you know, they're being like doped, and you know what it happens. You know, if in our world, we would have superpowers. We would be extremely abusive in a sense that it brings this destructiveness that comes from the ability to make a decision at such high costs. The fact that you have the power to decide, it's actually a scary thing rather than having the freedom to decide, which is a different thing. Having the freedom and the power to decide, these two are kind of the underlying dimensions for conflict throughout our history. You know, being in a state where you have the power to decide over the lives of others, and then you have the freedom, which means you, I don't even know what it means.
But they are two sides of the same coin, right? In that sense. And
in most cases, yes. I don't know if it's a perfect match, but for most instances, yes.
And this idea also of level of intensity of which you can actuate the power of your decision or not, right? And the most dangerous one are the one that we are not able to foresee, that we are not suspecting of having such a power, right?
But it's also, you know, you have the trolley problem, you know, when you have the power to decide over the lives of others, but you don't have the freedom to choose outside that frame. And it's, in most instances, this is a very often occurrence in our society. We are bound by the rules we have. You know, act within certain constraints ourselves, and then we place under those constraints whatever we can decide for others. And you know, there's a chain of constraining, from one level to another, which is really interesting to note. But do you think we've become better decision makers than we were 2,000 years ago? If we bring Aristotle today with us and we're like, okay, let's make decisions, let's see who makes better decisions.
Well, for Aristotle, we would have superpowers, actually. Like, I mean, the scale of the impact of any decision we can make today as an individual has never been so easy to access. Like, right, it was harder like 2000 years ago for anyone to reach out to so many people in one single click, right? Just in the power of relations and how words can spread and ideas can spread is just like a superpower, and this brings this idea of that you need balance in the system to mitigate the influx of power within one place, because if it's so easy to unleash a huge amount of power in one single place in the system, you can basically like destroy it from within. Like it's a what is the term? An implosion, right? In that sense, that you basically can break what makes the system works as basic relationships, in that sense. And I find it really interesting. And how do you put in place like counter or ways to mitigate those influx of power when everyone has like the equivalent of atomic bomb at the fingertip, you know?
Well, hopefully because we all have atomic bombs, we kind of live in a Cold War situation.
Yeah, that's true.
Mutually assured destruction, yeah.
So, you know, in many ways, I think that in today's world, we have so much like technological leverage that our in terms of our ability to have, you know, this power to influence and do all sorts of things, it's virtually unlimited. Like we are given very free leverage and free access to power. And additionally, we also have kind of like analytical ability to solve, many problems. I think a bigger problem is the lack of will, because you know, one of the things is like my brother-in-law, you know, he can analyze the problem and kind of like understand the optimal solution and whatnot, but it's convincing others that kind of makes them too lazy to pursue the actual end rational goal. It's that, you know, the kind of Girardian theory kind of made in practice is just that, you know, we kind of are creatures of habit in a sense. And so if we don't value the satisfaction of success, of being able to convince others and achieving, you know, this end goal of accomplishments, and we value really more of just our peace of mind and not to have, you know, like conflict and stress with our colleagues, then of course we're not going to pursue, you know, the rational ends of solutions, right? I think that actually predominates the most. Now, on the flip side, anybody who does have a will to want to change the world, right? Anybody who is ambitious, that plus the free access of leverage, that becomes quite dangerous, and that conflict that Diana mentioned. So, you know, then it becomes kind of a weird paradox, which is that maybe the optimal solution is just to make people dead in the inside, so then they don't tamper with the system and become terrorists, right? What are your thoughts? I mean, this is a brave new world, you know, Huxley solution, which is to get everybody all toxicity up with Soma, feel good, and, you know, high on weed, and basically just have a pharmacological to society, right? But
yeah,
I mean, you know what? The classic examples, no need for like Soma, you just have torture and communism. So that's not far-fetched. But yeah, I mean, we see how we tilted from having this potential to act and create so much change in the world and go towards a desired future as designers and all that entails. But then we realize how much impact we can have on it, and it becomes dangerous, especially when one individual or one specific group of individuals holds that power and they are not sharing it with others. So yeah,
Matt, what you described with your brother-in-law, like, I mean, it's the curse of the analyst, right? Anyway, you see things that you can't really do anything about.
In many ways, we are, you know, analysts, and we're really powerful. And as analysts, we make AIs that are analysts. But then in the end, we, the AIs, bots, don't actually make the decisions. The decision-making is part of a nexus, which is the abilities of, I guess it's the talent of good communicators, right? And the talent of the good communicators and good communicators, their access to a network with not the best analysts, but with good enough analysts who are also somewhat good communicators too, to be able to kind of, you know, communicate the insights of the data that are like, you know, strategic in a way that can be used in a way to convince others, right? To fix an alignment problem, which is, you know, profitability, or, you know, basically promotion or status games, right? Being able to play a status game using the data from the analytics, using the information from the analytics, that's how organizations, you know, through and through operate successfully. Because if they don't operate successfully, everybody's getting a paycheck, but the organization is just in stasis and hasn't really, you know, made anything new. And it's just really just doing a lot of things to keep competition at bay, right? Everybody is just on Soma. That's
but I'm rather skeptical about the fact that successful companies are good at analysis, actually. They are good at beliefs, and sometimes they are right with their beliefs. And they justify after the fact with analysis. I'm not saying it's always like that, but many of them are always like that, right?
I agree. I think will is more, having the will to power, having that will is far more important than analytical capabilities. Yeah. You use the analytical capabilities to justify afterwards or to, you know, build excuses. But I mean, you then again, like, it's usually a prelude, you know, the depth and height of your analysis usually gives you a lot much more space to play with. And then that helps build more ambition, right?
So Mark, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, well, it kind of, you were along the same lines around the fact that the companies that deal very much with analytics have a dehumanizing effect in that everything comes down to this quantitative analysis, as opposed to what previously would have been understood as some kind of qualitative analysis around human nature and behavior, right? That mm-hmm. I think those are, and they lead to different kinds of decision making. Or actually, I shouldn't say that, they lead to different kinds of decisions being taken, right? So that was, and I think that those companies that persist seem to have a greater understanding of the qualitative components of their existence and how it is that they perpetuate their story rather than the quantitative, right? Like good, if you want to get down to it, good brands are human in a way, right? Or understand the human aspect of the, I'll say the customer base or the world. They understand the way that you need to exist beyond data, right? In stories. And they may use the stories to craft that data or react to things that are resonating or that kind of thing. But I think that the initial impetus is more around the qualitative than the quantitative. Yeah. I think just basically what Kevin was saying.
Yeah. I would just, my personal feeling about that is, I totally agree with you, although I wouldn't say it's necessarily the company entirely that's had this understanding, but some part of it. And
yeah,
that's enough for it to work, right? Because we need coherency, we don't need consistency, we don't need everyone to understand how human works. We need just enough and in the right places for it to align in the right direction.
Agreed. Yeah, it's like an organ within the organization that understands it.
To what was said before, I want to bring up maybe something about action and ethics, which is the privilege to action. Because if we think about how options and opportunities are available to us, and we see them as as a network, as a network of things available to us, they are also in some way available to other people. And what someone that is good at, you know, making picking the right option and acting upon that has a privilege towards this action that he not necessarily stole, but he removed or in some way or influenced the environment in a way that others won't have the same opportunities for action anymore. And in terms of ethics and philosophy behind that is that in a more, I would say, naturalistic approach to it, that there's a reciprocity or reciprocal element to the action and the environment and others that we don't necessarily always see. We see the outcome of the privilege of action, which is that some people won't have access. It's already difficult for them to have access to some opportunities or some actions. And those who have the most opportunity toward this kind of options will take them removing those actions from others, right? I'm not framing it in the proper way, but just to give an image. And sometimes it's how how the system is built that constrains things in that direction, and sometimes it's purely accidental. And it's not necessarily harmful. This is where I want to just draw a line, that it's not necessarily harmful in that sense, that it's a bad thing to act, because if you don't want to influence anything, you just don't be here, and you are just nihilist in practice, right? But that's the kind of idea, and how we, as designers, we see that, because I don't perceive it, ethics in design and ethics in general, as just you have some, you know, ground common principles that says, oh, this is bad, this is good, and you just act always upon, you know, based on those of those static rules, because situations change, and when you are in novel situations but you don't know about anything, you don't know also about the extent of the good and the bad of whatever things you could do or not do in that space, right? So it makes no sense of having like fixated static rules to define those things. It has to come from experience. So I don't know how you stand about that. And
are you talking about like ethical rules, or what kind of rules are you?
Here I was implying ethical rules, but can be like some principles we want to apply all the time that we perceive as good principles to follow in any case.
Yeah. The kind of like the plane crash in the Andes as an example, right? That is a complete and total change of context, and yet moral or ethical standards are carried forward up into a certain point where it becomes about survival, right? There is still this notion that you can take what you have learned elsewhere in a different context into the new context.
Yes.
And try and establish that, right? Like it's, so it's—
Yeah, that's transposability, I agree.
Yeah, yeah. And so you do bring something with you until the boundaries of the context, I guess, start to gnaw away at the pyramid, you know, the hierarchy of like Maslow's kind of hierarchy, right? At some point it devolves, but there's always a kind of an attempt to carry forward that order with you, that learned order.
Huh. But if it's necessarily about laws and order, is it about order? I'm not just sure of that. Matt, go ahead, sorry.
So two thoughts. One image that kind of popped into mind about your comments, Kevin, was that it's very popular to hate on the winners, right? Because that's the world that we live in. There's all these winners, you know, all these big tech companies like Amazon, Google, and the only thing to do is to criticize, because they've left a world of negative space for the rest of us to innovate from, right? So in other words, like to your point, you were saying that once you do something, once you commit to an action, the universe gets on your side, and you get the tailwind of, yes, you're doing the right thing. This is the linear Western, you know, philosophical sense of the future. And then you actually get to implement all that through leverage, right? Through this like amazing tailwind. Goethe says that once you commit, the universe gets on your side, right? And so so then all of a sudden the success is there, and no one else can build a number one search engine, because there's only room for number one. And so then the only thing you can complain about is privacy. The only thing you can complain about Amazon is it's a monopoly. And then it's all hating on winners. We're all hating on monopoly. Right, and so the hate on winners becomes kind of like this new brand of ethics that comes as a result of the reality that we live in. And number two, to Mark's point about I think carrying forward, you know, so basically taking from one game and then transposing some of these lessons learned onto the next one to you know, kind of craft and I mean, of course, from an ethical point of view, from experimentation and all that stuff, if you are in the mode to explore and you're not just trying to optimize for, if the Western civilization project were to optimize for every single drop of oil that we burn, that we failed unimaginably because, we optimize for freedom, right? And so like that, therefore, if we're optimizing for freedom, then we are optimizing essentially for waste and discovery and search, right? And so then, we're not optimizing for that efficiency as a whole, right? From a system view. But what, from a long-term perspective, and this is kind of like a more of an economic Adam Smith thing, is that while we're all optimizing for freedom, we might be able to optimize for this sense of like long-term macro sustained concept of Western linearity, that the future is predictable, right? And that's where we construct rationality as kind of like, it's like we weren't born with rationality, but we have to earn rationality and build it and hold and uphold it and maintain it. And this is kind of the edifice of rationality in society.
Yeah, I would have like probably a different definition of rationality that you seems to use, Matt, because I make a distinction between being rational, I mean logical, and I do think like this is something that is separated and rationality. Oh, sorry, there's a dog that wants to participate. Hey. being rational doesn't necessarily mean that we aim to optimization, or that we aim to like some kind of objectiveness of what we are doing. But I think it's it's for another discussion, because it's a vast topic. But I understand what you mean. I'm just like I don't necessarily agree with the fact that it's because of rationality that we see that as a result. Yeah.
Well, I think, the power of reason comes when we question our decisions or justify them, but I'm not sure how much do we integrate or infuse it in the decision-making process itself. Because, you get the whole neuroscience of decision-making, the fact that you're deciding something even before you actually make it conscious. Somewhere in the brain, it's triggered towards that certain decisions. So it makes it this really mysterious. Worldview do you have? Do you believe in an indeterminate world or a determinate, or regardless, you kind of navigate different levels of where you have this free will or where you don't have it, and there's a destiny somewhere given at birth and you're supposed to just act this way? But, regardless of all these dimensions that could or could not play a part, it's just interesting to ponder at how we come to get in the power of deciding. Do you remember your first decision you've ever made as a child, or when was the first decision that you made and you became conscious about it? Because probably, I'm not sure if that's entirely the case for everyone, but I think for a child, the first decision they make is, besides crying and, it's lying when you decide to do otherwise, and that's how you exercise your freedom towards something, is deciding to actually, it's a lie. It's a very immoral decision that we make. And we talk here about ethical decisions. But, that irrational?
They must hold some kind of negativeness in order to stick in our mind so that we can recall it. And so in some way, the one we will recall of as a decision is the one that has the most effect on how we perceive the situation at the time. And there must probably be decision that had impact in some way that we perceived as negative, either for us or for ones we love. So that's funny that you asked this question in that framing.
Well, you know, regardless, it's still hard to know.
Yeah, that's
so I would say that the first maybe moral decision that you make would be to choose not to cry, in a sense. Maybe you might have just a sudden consciousness of what your actions are doing, which is that, sure, you get what you want, but do you really need to get what you want? And so if so, isn't just much more pleasant to stay
calm? Are you talking to a baby who just needs milk?
No, but I would say that there is, if there is a need for milk, right? You cry because you're in pain. You're in pain of this type of like lack of something or this aesthetic, you know, a pain or a lack of pleasure, right? But I would say that conservation of your energy, of not having to cry, so then you don't, you know, have like a hoarse throat or whatever, a sore throat from crying all the time. I think that conservation of energy, that principle, right, is kind of like a delayed gratification that is slowly learned throughout time.
Yeah, slowly learned. Really slowly.
Babies are very smart about that.
Yeah, really slowly learned. I can tell you, like, they can cry all night whether they are exhausted or not. So conservation of energy is not something that applies.
Yeah, but imagine if
you try with silence. Yeah, the idea that whole, was that fervorizing where you just let them go? I mean, you want to talk about like a test of will. You know, I think there's also this notion that that's a communication medium, and then you learn to communicate ways that are more effective. But what I'm interested in going back to the lying for a moment, which is like, at what point is there a realization that the lie is somehow wrong? Right? Like, do you feel bad because you told an untruth? Like, where does that conditioning come from? Right?
But yeah, I would say for kids at the beginning, there's no distinction between a lie and fabulation. Just being able to invent things for, like, in some sense, it's an increase of option for the kids. That's what it is. Even the lie is an increase of option.
But at some point, it's an optimization for the present, right? My parent is going to be angry because I broke this thing, and if I deny breaking it, then, you know, I won't get in trouble. But it doesn't play out, right? The fact is that breaking it and lying is worse than just breaking it. And eventually you might learn that if there are consequences, mm-hmm. right? So, like, there are some people in the world who we won't name who never face consequences and therefore lie with impunity, you know. But there's this interesting thing when the child starts to reason and starts to weigh the cost of lying against the cost of being honest. I mean, I think it has to do with the context and everything like that. But I think there's a moment where there is some kind of rational objection in there where you take the short-term pain to avoid the longer-term greater pain, like an inverse marshmallow test, you know?
Assuming there's a symmetry in the world, yes. I think a child would very quickly learn to take the path towards one honesty, but you're not really rewarded when you say, yes, I broke the vase. You're still going to get punished. So if you lie, you feel like you can get out of it. So
it's totally conditioned. I agree. Well, 100%. Also, if there is, like, you know, if you get away with it kind of consistently, then you will form a different attachment to lying.
Yes.
It'll have greater benefit, right? So I think it's entirely conditioned.
Yeah, that's the affordance of the of the situation, clearly.
I would take lying, the act of lying, as something even more fundamental, as in a break in consensus. Because from a first order principle, you could say that just being a contrarian, like if there was a group of three people and two agree, but you know, and you're outvoted, you're going to be outvoted, but you just decide to take the other one, you know, that in itself could be kind of seen as a lie. But you know, in some cases, contrarian stances can actually be the more the better outcome. I don't know what the quote better would really mean, but yeah, I think this used several times already, but
we don't hear you, Matt.
You know, lost communication.
Hello. At least on my side, it was.
Hi.
Yeah. Ironically, sound came back when you said loss of communication.
Yeah. So loss of communication from this submarine, right? And they thought that it was during the Cold War, and they thought that temperature was hot, and they were just like about to go to nuclear war. And then two. So the only way for them to launch a nuclear missile is that all three of the commanding officers had to agree. Two said, let's go for it. And then only one abstained, right? And so it's one of those cases where being the contrarian was probably the better decision, quote unquote, better. Again, like...
But what it did exactly was to hold action in order to increase options. So in that sense, what it made actually is allow the circumstances to rearrange. So now it's clearer what the decision, the real best decision can be, right?
Correct.
So it removed ambiguity of the situation by holding, by not making any decision to act. Which is exactly in this type of situation, exactly the role of the contrarian is to give time to sync, you know, all the signals and actually be able to make a better decision, because you wait until it's, you know, it's clearer.
And this cannot be highlighted enough, right? The powerful role of the contrarian is to suspend judgment and kind of play this active role of lying. Right, because you know, if we are not just creatures that only go based on logic, right? I will refrain from using rational, but if we do things that are not just based off of logic, but more based off of habit, behavioral, cultural, then our natural mode is to be of consensus, and mm-hmm. one of the principles of consensus is to never lie, right? To always tell the truth. But there are, you know, obviously there are cases where being contrarian and lying serve a kind of like this usefulness. Now, I think not everybody can do this type of ethical mental calculation on all the, you know, the branching of your decision trees, but most people have a decent compression algorithm to be able to intuitively do it based upon experiences, right?
Yeah. Well, the problem with the contrarian is because they hold decision in order to wait for the situation to be clearer, is like they can miss opportunities as well. So if you are always the contrarian, you lose as often as you win, right? There's no, like it's 50-50 each time, and it's no riskier than always acting upon whatever you want to act, right? It's not better necessarily.
Well,
it depends highly on circumstances in that sense.
Yeah, so the way I would see it is that contrarians, they lose a lot more than they win, but when they do win, they have an outsized reward to risk ratio,
right?
And so balancing those out is really what determines your personality as a decision maker. You know, sometimes you play the role of as a contrarian. Sometimes you play a very flexible role of being a consensus and a contrarian, right? There are personalities of decision making that kind of are better predictors of who you are, and like, you know, and kind of simulate your judgment based off of like which, you know, categories of aesthetics, ethics that you subscribe to more.
But I think once you begin to identify yourself with this one way of decision making, you're no longer actually that free in the sense that you're actually deciding. You become quite unconscious, and then you just go automatic on the option that is just so predictable to your behavior, and no longer exercise the power to decide.
Yeah, but you know, in some cases, I would say that many people call this state of work or state of thinking flow, right? Where like you do a lot of things, you know, unconsciously, but you, I don't know, many people say that their flow state, they're the most productive. But that might just be a very subjective, you know, interpretation, right? Very biased, but
I just want to come back to the fact that you mentioned that the contrarian kind of lie. And I want to understand what you mean by that, in the sense that my question right away is towards whom he's lying, because I do see that he's lying to himself by not accepting the consensus, but not necessarily to the others, because he sees something that the others might not see, right? So although they don't accept it, it's not necessarily per se a lie, right? So the lie is mostly towards himself. But then if you agree with that statement, how is it different from consensus, where you agree to remove your own opinion and accept the consensus? That if you were to try, you would be able to find a contradiction to the consensus. If you really want to try, you can always find contradictions to any position, right? But you won't do it in order to keep the consensus. So in that sense, it's still a lie towards yourself. You remove yourself from any contradiction that you could bring forwards to the table, right? So
to clarify more precisely, what I really mean by kind of the foundation of being a contrarian, right, is to satisfy one of two things. The first one, being able to identify an outsized risk-reward ratio, something that pays a little bit more in order to deviate from this consensus action, right, which is to lie. That's criteria number one. I think the second one is the one that you're kind of talking to, which is lying to yourself. And this, I totally agree with you too. Number two is having the ability to be self-deceiving. Because it's very difficult, you know, from a social perspective, to be contrarian, right? It's, you know, not only that you put your own reputational and social risk on the table to disagree, but, you know, you could be outcasted, right? There's a lot of evolutionary biological triggers that go against you lying and being contrarian and all that stuff. But if you self-deceive yourself, if you engage and are actively engaged in self-deception and lying to yourself, there is this hope that you can be a hero out of this. You know, when all things are done, you're the hero, right? And that's the that's where self-deception becomes a narrative and so on and so forth, and where it can actually be a momentum building thing that builds upon your personality to be a perennial contrarian, right? But, you know, again, like, I guess the danger of all of that is that you've engaged and you subscribe to a philosophy that is one that's based upon self-deception, and it's like a gambler's mentality in a sense. And, you know, there I would actually even say the word that it's irrational, right? But it can produce some useful system, you know, improving impetus, right? Like it doesn't always have to weigh down on momentum. It can sometimes help build better consensus over time.
I largely agree with what you said. I don't know if contrarians are necessary calculators, like people that anticipate so much always, like you can be one at a certain given time, because it's so unclear that any decision can be a bad decision, so, and you know it, so it's the safe position is to be the contrarian, right? So you don't have a chess game in your mind where you already planned like three or four steps forwards. You just expect the situation to give clarity and therefore you hold in that sense.
Well, before you continue, I just want to disagree that it was not based upon, you said that the contrarian was the safe choice. I would say that consensus is the safe choice, right? Unless you've conditioned yourself with the expectation that being wrong is okay always. And by that time, you're already an assigned role of contrarian already. But, you know, we're not playing role-playing here, which is that you get to be devil's advocate. The only point where a contrarian is an active free will event is that you actually see something in this contrarian viewpoint, and you want to be the devil's advocate. You're not assigned that role. You want to be that role. You advocate for that role because you believe in it, or you engage in self-deception in a way that you've deceived yourself into believing, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When it's dangerous to me is where you are not self-aware of that, right? That's all of that conditions that are risky, right? This is where it's more the Kumbler situation where people just, you know, cannot see the distinction between the game and the reality, right? That you have like this ability to have like make a step backwards and like watch yourself in that sense, like you know that where the risks are and where you want the situation to lean towards, right? And you are self-aware of that context.
I would say that the upside is not being a contrarian. Right, the in that moment, you don't actually see yourself as a contrarian. You come into the situation with a certain set of beliefs. The fact that, let's say it's a 2 out of 3 situation, those two other people's thoughts, ideas, assessment of the situation does not convince you to change your mind, right? So the goal is not to be, it's not that you suffer from some kind of oppositional defiance disorder, right? And you are... No, and you are a devil's advocate because that's what you see your personality to be. It's that you have a belief beyond that you are, you know, that despite evidence to the contrary to other people see, you see something different. Those are the people I think who are successful, not those who like see themselves as devil's advocates, therefore enter into every position or situation with that kind of. You know, like that's, I'm going to enact what I see as my personality, which is to kind of be in the face of a preponderance.
Some people are like that. Yeah, some people are like that.
I know a few people. I know a few people. They're incredible project anchors. And you can't, like, it's really hard. Yeah. So I think there's a role for it, but I think it has to do simply with the way that you digest information and that you need to be able to take in the information of these other people. They might still be incorrect, right? Based on whatever. As a designer, that will happen to you if you have a pair of clients, right? Or a client, which is more than one person, and they both hold the same belief, but that's because they're in love with their product, for example.
Yes.
Right? So you will. That's a very practical example of where it's two against one, but you're not, you don't suffer from ODD. You just see something that the other two people don't, right?
Yeah.
The notion of self-awareness, like you say, is really important because you have to understand why it is that your beliefs are formed the way that they are, and why it is that you're not changing your beliefs confronted by other information.
This is what I wanted to say. Like the difference, I don't mean self-awareness, like you have this person of being the devil's advocate and you go in the room and you want to destroy everyone. this is not the idea, right? Because then you are not self-aware of that. You suffer from this urge to push towards this position as much as you make the other suffer from this position as well, right? So because you it's like a servitude type of position where you are servant of your emotional response to the situation, right? So I mean, in that sense, it's different because the self-awareness that it brings. What the self-awareness brings you is the ability of understanding others' positions as well, and be the contrarian, not necessarily in the like what most people have in mind when we have this image of the contrarian that just say no to everything and just you're wrong on that, and you know, bringing cold facts and say, oh, this and this and this, and therefore, tack, you are, you know, not necessarily, but being subtle and having subtlety in how you bring arguments against others' position, and even maybe playing the others' position just enough for them to understand how they can move from their position to yours, right? So it necessarily being contradictory in nature, right?
I would say also, and Mark kind of reminded me of this, is that my real point is that if you're a contrarian and you bring forth kind of a little bit, a piece of yourself into that opinion, then it actually has both self-deception, because again, like maybe you've already deceived yourself to be to come into the argument with a certain point of view, right? You know, in a sense, your initial state is your self-deception. It's your initial state, right? So, but when you bring that in, it brings a little bit more value than if you were to devil's advocate role play and just want to be contrarian just so you can be the gatekeeper to decision making. In some ways, it's a powerful play, right? If you're the one person who prevents action because there's no unanimity, then everybody has to, you know, stroke your ego or you know, give you a raise or stuff like that, right? You know, basically it's a power play. But if you are genuinely concerned about the quality of decision making and you bring a little bit, a piece of yourself into it, I don't know if that's necessarily better. But I will say it's not a power play. It's a little bit more authentic, but at the same time, it's a little naive too, because again, you're kind of unfiltered when you bring in your own position, kind of like in a natural way. What I am trying to state here is that there is a third opposition, which is not bringing your own, little bit of peace or to play a power play, but to, again, those two criterias, which is you have to be comfortable with your self-deception, number one, and make it potentially sustainable and infectious to others. That's how you be effective, right? Number one. And number two is to be able to identify and articulate that risk reward proposition, right? That's outside of what consensus would be. And I think that's my main.
Yeah, this reminds me, because if we bring that, we anchor it back to this notion of decision making and action. Sometimes the best action you can do is design something that is not wanted. And I had like several examples in the past that where people were stuck in something that you perceive as a designer obviously wrong. You know, it's you can explain it however you want. People won't see it because they don't have the disposition to see it. They don't have your experience. They don't have the same knowledge or skills to perceive how what they can try now from their point of view, from their perspective, can only lead to a certain set of circumstances that are not wanted, right? You are not categorical on the type of result, but you know it will be not something good for anyone, right? And you are stuck in this position, and you know that the only play you can do, the only thing you can do is design what they wanted and design the thing they don't want, but you know will succeed, and show them what happens, right? And then the things unfolds, and there's something interesting there, because most of the time people I had like stronger position with like some arguments about what we should do, and they were, you know, they were so certain of what they wanted, and yet so wrong about how to do it, and you know, and but so convinced that you cannot move them actually. And after that happened, it became again the consensus that it would not have been in other way. Like they, you know, if they don't realize that they were wrong, they realize that they agree with what you did, which is not exactly the same, right? That they move their position to yours, but not with dissonance, basically. There's no opposition between their previous position and yours anymore, right? And this is interesting because that means in a certain way it comes from the practice of unfolding the thing and realizing they were wrong, right? That it's not wrongness, it's just that they're just realigning themselves with the situation, right? And I find it really interesting, and I think it's an interesting way to escape some kind of situation where even if you are a contrarian, you cannot convince others of a different position, right? That you want them to move and you cannot, then you create the circumstances for them to be able to move. It might be the case that they won't agree necessarily with you in the end, but they still move their position to something else, right? And I find it interesting.
You can always push them off the stairs if they're not moving.
Yeah. Kicking the knees and...
you have to find the space to build whatever that solution is.
Yes.
Right? Like it's not always possible. And the other thing too is I think that...
And it's not free. It's always costly anyway. Yeah, agree.
Yeah, it's costly. Yeah, yeah. And so being a contrarian, I think, is different than having a contrary opinion. Right? Like if you self-style yourself as, you know, I'm a contrarian and that's part of my personality, that's a less genuine way of approaching the situation than say, well, I just happen to hold a contrary opinion in this particular sense.
So here's another thing is that, look, I would even say that there is an authentic usefulness for a contrarian to just, you know, style him or herself as a contrarian. There is a usefulness in this sense because to Kevin's point, right, in order for him to be able to build a better design, right, is through this dialectic process. And to Diana's point, what if you just push him off the stairs? Then there's no contrarian. I could just design however I want. But I would say I've been in this situation before as Kevin, which is that my manager wanted something and it was clearly not the right one in my opinion. So I built something that succeeded, right? That's iteration number one. And then number two, what my manager says is, oh, you just design everything from now on. I won't have a say in the matter. Well, what that ended up doing was it took the wind away from my sails, right? Because I needed that momentum, that extra emotional momentum to prove my manager wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so like the quality suffered. Like it was like Diana mentioned. I didn't push him off the stairs. This guy, he just jumped off the bridge himself because he lost. And then without that dialectic process, you do not have a sustainable fuel for creating, you know, better processes sustainably in the future. Like sustainability, what does that mean? It means you're optimizing for the long term. You know, it's not just a one-step iteration, but several steps, right? And in order to have a contrarian in your team to just be perennially wrong and to offer that dialectic authentically or inauthentically, it doesn't matter. I think that there is some value. There's some hidden value for sure. Maybe not in like a rational quantitative sense, but I guess quantitatively from a long-term perspective, you might be able to see that if you like, you know, compare like one firm or another with different like, you know, personality types and all that stuff. But again, like I think that there is like a real world example of that happening.
But then, yeah, there's two things I want to say about what you just said. This this is a position that is grounded into privilege of being able to be the contrarian. And as you said, there's a curse to it. But if you are able to play this role, that means you are in a position that you where you can do it, right? And in a sense, there's a privilege to be the contrarian, which is in many cases not one that you can be actually, right? Because you don't have this privilege, you don't have the disposition or the means or the power to be that type of role, right? And it, to another point, I think the contrarian is not a role, but is a heuristic, and it's much more useful in that sense, because then you can extract the person needed for the role from this utility of the role, right? Because now it's just a tool you can play or you can use whenever it's the most useful, right? So that means useful in the sense that you have the capability of using that tool, and it makes sense in context, right? And as much, you know, so then it becomes less binary. Like it's not you are this role or you are another role. Then you can have several heuristics for several changes of context, right? And then move from one to another and maximize your chances in, you know, in the future, whatever that might be, right? And I feel like it's a bit more useful in that sense. Yeah, sorry.
Can you always disagree with the parts, but then agree with the whole? Like we were talking about this in the beginning. So a contrarian is not a consistently contrarian. To be that, you need to have this ability to disagree with certain bits, because this is what ultimately, you know, we are playing towards a certain consensus. Otherwise, there's no purpose to a contrarian if they are not doubting certain elements. Otherwise, they're just chaotic disruptors. So, for example, now
I have
to be contrarian and jump out and see. We a league informally adopted a stray cat, so I need to go and check on it. So I'm going to leave you on that note.
Yeah, I think we will end like quite soon because I plan like 1 hour and a half, so well, a bit over that.
We always go aboard, but let's think about part three, maybe in this remaining conversation that you're having. It would be interesting to think about the part three and narrow down once more. I think that would be interesting. But thank you, guys. Take care. See you next time.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Diana actually mentioned a really good point, which is if you're always disagreeing, then technically, you're no longer providing any signals anymore. You're just the boy who cried wolf, right? And then everybody yes. ignores you. And then your role as a contrarian actually just lost its overall utility just off of that. So it's actually quite the opposite of what she said, which is that you're not just creating chaos. What ends up happening is you create so much, filtering from everybody that you're just blend in to the background, right? You just cause just nothing but noise afterwards. But
yes.
Anyways, it was a great conversation. So thank you very much for hosting.
Yeah, thank you too. And so outside of those specific discussion about philosophy and design, we have the virtual chalet. So that are less constrained. They are just about whatever we want to discuss at that point. So it can be about anything. And I think next time, probably it will be next week. So the virtual chalet are once every 2 weeks. So we have some kind of rhythm. And then we have some events like this one, which are, outside of this schedule. So don't hesitate to join. Maybe next time on the virtual chalet, we will discuss about what could be the next round, round three, on design and philosophy. So
can't wait. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Bye.
Have a good